Let's jump into it today. We are in a new series called First John, and we are literally slowing it down a little bit. My forte is a little bit more preach a series, but we're going to slow it down and do a book study in this series. And we are looking at this book of First John. So as we jump into this, I'm just going to read it as it is, and then we will jump into its contents as we go. First John chapter 1, verse number 1 says, "We proclaim to you the one who existed from the beginning, whom we have heard and seen. We saw him with our own eyes and touched him with our own hands. He is the word of life. This one who is the life itself was revealed to us, and we have seen him. And now we testify and proclaim to you that he is the one who is eternal life. He was with the Father, and then he was revealed to us. We proclaim to you what we ourselves have actually seen," key statement, "actually have seen and heard, so that you may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that you may fully share our joy. This is the message we heard from Jesus. This is the message that we heard from Jesus and now declare to you. God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God, but go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth, but if we are living in the light as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we claim we have no sin, we're only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. If we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar and showing that his word has no place in our hearts." The author of this book is John, the apostle John, the John that was the brother of James that Jesus called off the shores of Northern Galilee and said, "Hey, come and follow me." He's a blue collar guy, a fisherman. He knows what's up. He's an individual in the gospels. When the gospel he wrote, John would say, "The one, I'm the disciple in which Jesus loved. I'm the beloved." The boy spoke highly of himself and thought highly of himself. "I'm the loved one of Jesus. Jesus loves me." This is the John that whenever Jesus died, he helped set up the church in Jerusalem. This is the John, early church, Peter, James, and John setting up the church in Jerusalem. He would go on to move to Ephesus, modern day Turkey, and he would be a church leader there, establishing the church and mentoring other believers. While he was in Ephesus, modern day Turkey, this is where he wrote 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. This is the John that whenever the Roman occupation and persecution of Christians happened, he was exiled to Patmos, an island just out from Turkey, in between Turkey and Greece, right? It's a small island out there. And while he was exiled, this is when he had the revelation of end times. And the book of Revelations was written. This is the same John. After he was on Isle of Patmos, he would go back to Ephesus and he would die there. This is the John that literally everyone else was martyred, but John lived a long, healthy, happy life and mentored Christians, and he would eventually die in Turkey. That is the John that wrote this book. Now, this John is writing this book, 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John, to a group of believers in Ephesus, modern day Turkey, to combat bad ideology. That's why he's writing the book. He's strengthening Christians, but bringing perspective and clarity to bad ideology that's coming from individuals known as Gnostics. These individuals that believe in divine truth is given to a select group of people, and their truth was the truth. And he's confronting this bad ideology that's being spoken to Christians, and some Christians are actually believing it. How many of you guys have ever been in that place before in your life where something is being stated about you or somebody else, or maybe even a situation, but the reality is something far different than what is being projected? Anybody ever been there before? Like, somebody's talking mess about one of your friends, and you're like, "You don't even know them. But I know them, and this is what's true." That ain't true. That's not who they are. Or maybe a circumstance. This happens a lot in high school. Oh, I know what happened. This all happened over here. You're like, I was there. It didn't happen like that, okay? Right? In the workplace, you're like, come on now. It didn't happen like that. That is not what happened. Right? We know as the veterans inside here, sometimes what's portrayed in the media may be different than the reality on the ground of war. What's projected is not actually true. It's curating a narrative. And what we know about life is, I love the statement that those that write history are the ones that control history. And it's best to go back to the originators, the individuals that were actually there. Well, who actually was there that wrote it down? As opposed to who's writing about it a couple hundred years later, right? Who was actually eyewitnesses to it? And that's what John is saying in here. I'm an eyewitness to it. So we jump into John chapter 1, verse 1. He says, we proclaim to you the one who existed from the beginning, whom we have heard and seen. We saw him with our own eyes and touched him with our own hands. He is the word of life. This one who is life itself was revealed to us, and we have seen him. The Gnostics were saying that Jesus wasn't fully human. He was some pseudo being. And John's like, you lost your dang mind. Jesus is real. I heard him with my own ears. I saw him with my own eyes. And I touched him with my own hands. Like, you have no clue what you're talking about. And you're spreading these lies. And he's saying, Christians, hey guys, Jesus is real. No, I touched him. I heard him. I've seen him. He really is the truth. I mean, John, when he would write in his gospel, one of the first things out of the gate is the word became flesh and dwelt among us. John, like, I know this to be true. I was with him. I'm the beloved. I know my boy. So these Gnostics are creating ideas that are untrue. And let me just tell you today, as Christians, you got to know Jesus intimately. Because you get into the second part of this, he's in, and now we testify and proclaim to you that he is the one who is eternal. He was with the Father, and then he was revealed to us. We proclaim to you what we ourselves have actually seen and heard, so that you may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We get fellowship because we get relationship with God in believing in the one and only Son of God, Jesus Christ. Verse 4, we are writing these things so that you may fully share our joy. John said, hey, I'm going to give you the truth, although there may be some lies about him out there. Let me just give you the truth, because here's the deal. I have fellowship with Jesus. I saw him die. I saw him get raised to life. John was the only disciple that was at the death. When he saw on the cross, John was the only disciple that was there that saw him die. John saw the death. John saw resurrection. John saw the Holy Spirit at work, descend into on Pentecost. John was a part of all of it and had an experience with it. And he said, hey guys, I'm giving you personal experience. I was there. And why is he saying it? Because he's like, hey, these individuals will lie to you to water down who Jesus is, that you don't get the real thing, so you don't experience the true joy. I'm trying to tell you all of this so that you can receive the joy that comes with knowing him. Come on, I'm just telling you today, is there anybody in here that has lost the joy of knowing Jesus? Have you lost sight of a good God that loved you, that saw you in your brokenness, when you were messed up, when you were tore up, when you were alone, whenever you were depressed, whenever you were anxious, and you saw God step into your broken, messed up life, and you came in humility and laid it down and said, God, I can't go anywhere else. Who shall I go to? And you showed up at the feet of Jesus, and in that instance, you found the joy that comes from knowing God and giving your life to Jesus Christ, and you have this joy that burst out of you, and you said, God, I will live for you forever. I will serve you forever. I will walk away from all the madness. This joy. Joy I got. Come on, it doesn't matter how long you've known Jesus. Have you lost your joy? I love how Spurgeon says it. Spurgeon says it this way. If any of you have lost the joy of the Lord, I pray you do not think it a small loss. If you lost the joy, I pray you understand how great of a loss that is. John's over here like, guys, I know Jesus, and I know what it feels like to know him and have a deep, rich relationship with him. Don't let the chaos of this world and the Gnostic ideology water him down to the truth of who he is and what he can do in your life. I share all of this because I want you to know this joy. It's a joy of your life. It's a joy that changes you. It's a joy that deals with all your chaos. It's a joy that overwhelms you. It's a joy that takes you from the pit and puts you on right standing with God. It's a joy that will take you from the worst of worst situation into an eternal hope of what God can do and how he will move through your circumstances. It is a joy that will wipe away every single one of your tears. It's a joy that will deal with every single one of the issues that come from your formation. When that person put his hands on you, it's a joy that will flow through in the middle of that. It's a joy that in the middle of the loss and the pain that you come from, it's a joy that'll find you and pull you out of that pit. It's a joy. I pray you know that joy. And John's trying to communicate that. Come on, this is a joy. Don't let the world water it down. Knowing Jesus and having fellowship with him changes everything. The disciples, or John was confronting this bad ideology. The Gnostics have themselves in a place to say, we have a predetermined belief system and Jesus has to fit within our narrative. There's no way that Jesus can be divine and human. We don't believe in that. So obviously, he's less than. It's not going to supersede our truth. This is no way that it's actually true, and we have to change what we believe in order to understand who he truly is, that we can get in alignment with what God is saying. And God's will, we already believe the way we believe. So Jesus, no, he is not divine. No, he was not fully human. He was a good man. He was a prophet. He was a, sound familiar? John's like, no. He was who he says he was. He did what he said he did. I was there. The same thing would be true in our culture today. We can't water down Jesus based on our own preferences. Just because we have a predetermined belief system. We got a little of this from academia. We got a little of this from YouTube. We got a little of this from Instagram. We got a little of this from whatever we got it from. And now all of a sudden, Jesus has got to fit our box. God has got all by himself. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. We got to get our lives in alignment with his truth. Come on, we can't reduce this life in Christ down to a cultural belief system that fits our predetermined ideology that's been set by people that don't even love Jesus. We can't reduce it down to a place to say, I just want to live my life and be able to come to church on Sunday. And where I get God and where I get my relationship is when I go to church on Sunday. We can't reduce it down to this place to say, I want forgiveness, but I do not want transformation. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. If we got our predetermined ideas, when we come to Jesus, we say, we deal with the predetermined ideas and say, I know nothing. Come on, is it Aristotle that says this one thing I know? That I know nothing. And a good place to be as a human is to say, one thing I know is, I know nothing. God knows it all. I am a sinner in desperate need of a savior. That's one thing that we say. So we can't put God faith into our box, reduce him down. We got to let God out of our box and say, you be God and I will be a servant of yours. Where you lead me, what you called me to do, what do I need to change? What do I need to adjust? I will do it in order to honor and please you with my life. I will lay it down as a living sacrifice. The first thing confronted in here was the idea of who Jesus was. The second thing that was confronted in here is Gnostics did not believe in righteous living. They believed you could live however you wanted to live. That there was only elite, elect people that received the divine information. And so it really didn't matter how you lived. It was that you received the divine information. So therefore, you're better than everybody else. And so what does John say? John's like, cool, love it. That's awesome. But here we go. This is the message we heard from Jesus and now declare to you, God is light and there is no darkness in him. The God Almighty over all of creation is perfect. He is pure. He is good. There is no wrong in him. Light is the purest form. You see light, it is the purest form of purity. There is nothing that can diminish it. It's light is light. I love it that God is the only infinite, eternal, and unchangeable spirit, the perfect being in whom all things begin and continue and end. Another way of saying God is perfect is to say God is light. He is perfect. So John's establishing God is perfect. He is light. Verse number 6. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God. I'm a Christian. I love God. I'm serving him faithfully. But we go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. We're lying. If we say, oh, we love God, we have fellowship with God, and then we keep on living la vida. That's literally what John is saying. How in the world are you gonna, God is light, and you have fellowship with light, but therefore you continue to live in darkness. How are you gonna do that? Says we're not practicing what the truth is, because the truth would lead us into the light. But if we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. What are you saying? Come on. You love God. You have fellowship with God. You're interacting with God. Come on. You open up your Bible every single day, and you're interacting with the word, the truth of God. And then the conviction that comes is like, I'm good. I'm gonna back away from the light of the word, the truth of God, and I'm gonna keep on living la vida, whatever I wanna live. I'm gonna do what I wanna do, whenever I wanna do it, however I wanna do it. What does light have to do with darkness? How do those two things work together? They don't. So you're only lying to yourself if you say I have fellowship with God, but you keep on living la vida. That's what he's getting into. He's getting into the trenches. Gnostics were confusing believers to think that their lifestyle and their living and their behaviors didn't matter to God. And John's like, you lost your dang mind. God is perfection, and he's calling his followers to live in the truth. Walk in the light. Don't lie to yourself. Walk in the light. Look at John 3:16, and I'll read all the way through verse 20. We all can read 3:16. We all can probably say it together, but it says this, for this is how God loved the world. We all say it together. He gave his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Amen. That's a good one. We all love that one. Come on, you know back in the day, we all had it on our signs when we were at wrestling. Anybody ever been to a wrestling? It's real. I've seen it with my own. I've never seen it with my own eyes, okay? Never been there. John 3:16. Now let's get into verse 17 through 20, where it's gonna get a little more straight up. And Christians gotta be really clear on this, because we love John 3:16 because it's grace-filled. But we get a little skittish when it gets to 17 because culture will say something different. So you better stand firm on 17 if you legit on 16. God sent his son into the world, not to judge the world, but to, say it out loud, to save it through him. Through who? Jesus. Through who? Through good behaviors, through your works, through me. Through what? Through Jesus, through him. There is no judgment against anyone who believes in him, but anyone who does not believe in him has already been judged for not believing in God's one and only son, Jesus Cristo. And the judgment is based on this fact. God's light came into the world, but people loved the darkness. People loved the darkness. They loved the darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. And all who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it for fear their sins will be exposed. Let's be honest. The wages of sin is real fun for a minute. But there's at some point in time you wake up and you say, what in the world am I doing? Why am I thinking like that? Why do I believe that ideology? Why am I acting like this? Why am I challenged by these thoughts and behaviors? Why do I keep on going back to this belief system? Why do I keep on allowing myself to slip into this mindset? Maybe it's because we're more comfortable in the dark and masked up than we are truly being in the light. It's much easier to hide ourselves from people. It's much easier to live in a space where we put a front on to everybody else and we're falling apart behind the scenes. It's much easier to act like we love Jesus, but man, we sure do love those late nights. We sure do love taking that extra pill. We sure do love smoking that thing. We sure do love drinking just a little too much to get us over the edge. We sure do love the jealous behaviors. We sure do love the envy that's on the inside of our hearts. We sure do love the hatred that comes out whenever we don't like somebody. We sure do love the gossip behind the scenes when we're trying to dismantle and bring somebody's character down. We sure do love the things that exist inside of the dark, because if we truly step into the light, then we gotta be exposed. We gotta give an account for these decisions. John's dealing with the mindset that if it matters to God, it should matter to us. If he is light, then we can't go on living in darkness. It doesn't matter if it's the external or the internal. Both will defile yourselves in the eyes of God. What do I mean? Jesus was very convicting to the religious because their sin was not external, it was internal. The sin was on the inside of their heart, their judgment, their criticism, their envy, their hatred, was on the inside of them. If we live in a world here today, the light of Jesus came into it. But if we step back from the light of Jesus, more than likely we love the dark more than we do love living in the light. He goes on to say, but those who do what is right come to the light so that others can see that they are doing what God wants. Isn't it amazing that the moment you step into the truth of God's word and following Jesus, it's not about us. We truly do pick up our cross and follow him. Because it's like when we step into the light, then we're revealing to everybody else the light that we're living is to honor God. It's not about us. Well, I wish I could. Well, we can't. That's called sin. Stepping truly into the light. So Romans chapter 13 would say this, Paul writing to the church in Rome, and Rome, my God, had all types of crazy sinful behaviors going on in a very pagan culture. You better believe it. Woo! But he says, this is all the more urgent for you know how late it is. Well, if it was late for them, it's late for us. He says, time is running out. Wake up, for our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. If it was soon for them, is really soon for us now. Peter, I mean, most of these apostles, and I'll be straight with you. Most of them thought Jesus was coming back in their lifetime. All of them. Jesus is gonna come back in our literal lifetime. But Peter would write this. Peter would write, and we may know the scripture, I can't, but he would write this. One day in heaven is 1,000 on earth, and 1,000 on earth is one day in heaven. Where is he writing that from? I thought it was gonna happen in my lifetime, but apparently God lives outside of human time and space. So maybe it's not happening, they're all aging. And so if it was near to them, it's really near to us today. And he goes on to say, the night is almost gone, the day of salvation will soon be here. So remove your dark deeds like dirty clothes and put on shining armor of right living, because we belong to the day. We must live decent lives for all to see. Don't participate in darkness of wild parties. Don't participate in the club life. Don't participate in the bar life. Don't participate in that type of lifestyle. It'll lead towards brokenness and destruction. It'll lead towards an inability to live a productive life. It'll lead towards over-drinking and trying to find yourself in somebody else's bed at the end of the night, or somebody in your bed that's not supposed to be there. Stay away from that craziness. Don't drink too much. Sexual promiscuity, sex with anybody, however, whenever, whatever, living as a prostitute. Really? Stay away from that lifestyle. Don't live like that. in moral living, in quarreling, in jealousy. Stay away from the fights. The demarcation point for a believer, if God is love, then his people should reflect love. Why are we angry with people? Why are we mad at everybody? Come on, we shouldn't be mad at anybody. We make peace. God blesses the peacemakers. We're peaceful people. Why are we jealous? We didn't work for it. That's why we don't have it. Don't be mad at somebody else because they do. Live in this state of contentment about your walk. You're walking in the light. You're living in the love. Let the fruit of the Holy Spirit flow out of you. Love, joy, peace, patience, guidance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. That is a great indication that you are connected to the vine and you are lit up by Jesus Christ. You can, apart from me, he says, you can do nothing. So what should be flowing out is the beauty of Christ inside of our lives. He said, instead, clothe yourself with the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ and don't let yourself think about ways to indulge your evil desires.
Let's get real, real.
What good does light have to do with darkness? If you call yourself in fellowship with God, stay away from the darkness. Deal with the darkness. Stay away from the behaviors and the mindsets. Stay away from the actions that don't reveal the truth of God is at work on the inside of your life. Come on, clothe yourself with the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Live as he has called us to live. The second thing he would confront, verse number 8, he says, if we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. A key place to be, Matthew 5, chapter 3. The first beatitude is God blesses those who realize their need for him. It's this desperation that we desperately need God. Without God, we are nothing. We're broken and desperate. We need him. So if we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves. It's the deception that the enemy will allow us to step in and be like, no, you're good. It's okay. And we justify our actions, unrighteous as they may be, as okay because they're okay in the eyes of man. But they're not in the eyes of God. It's like you're lying to yourself. You're living a life of deception. Don't be deceived. But confess your sin to God. Why? Because he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins, and he will cleanse us from all wickedness. Like if we're willing to be humble, we serve a gentle God, a loving God that will forgive us. Not an angry God that's gonna thump us on top of the head and I can't believe you and about time you got yourself together. No, a loving God that's like, I'm here. Open arms, walking away from the darkness and into the light. He's rejoicing at every single person that steps into the light. He says, if we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar and showing his word has no place in our hearts. God blesses those who realize their need for him. It's humility that leads us to a place where we repent. Humility, God, we don't have it together. God, we desperately need you. You know, Jesus would tell a story that confronts this. Luke chapter 18, verse number 10. Jesus would tell of two men. It says, two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other was a despised tax collector. A Pharisee, a religious individual, thought themselves better than everybody else. I know what truth is. And then the despised tax collector. A tax collector at this moment in time would be somebody that's working on behalf of the Roman government in order to tax the Jewish people. The Jewish people did not like tax collectors. They call it sellouts. Look at you. You're extorting your own people for your own gain and you're working with the occupation. I can't believe you. Despised. They hated tax collectors. But Jesus uses this analogy, this parable to tell the story. You got a religious mindset individual and you got a despised sinner. And they both go to church. And while they're in church, the religious person stands there and he's like, God, I thank you, God. I'm not like that lady over there that's living whatever life. I wasn't like her in the club last night. And I'm not like that guy over there that can't even keep his eyes open because more than likely he drank way too much last night. Good thing I'm not like them. And God, thank you. I'm definitely not like that person. Mm-hmm. Judging by what they're wearing, they ain't married and they ain't dressed in the clothes themselves with the love of the Lord. Amen. And definitely I'm not like that individual back there. Where's their wife at? But there's a kid next to him. Guess they had a kid out of wedlock. Thank you, God, that I'm not like them. You know, I fast and I pray. Oh, I'm amazing. Then Jesus says, but you get the tax collector that's at church, and he won't even lift his head up. He's just like, I'm a wreck. In light of how good God is, Jesus says he just beats his chest. One thing I know standing on this stage, I know the darkness. I know what it looks like. I know what it means to be sexually abused at 8 years old. I know what it means to live in darkness. I know what it means to feel like I was worthless. I know what it means like God overlooked me. I know what it means. I know what it means, what it looks like to live away from God. I know what it means to feel broken and hurt and lost. I know what it means personally. Understand, I'm not up here today to tout myself, but I'm here to beat my chest and say, God, look, you know how broken I am. And I think that's the heart of every believer that stays with it for the long haul. Every believer that makes it for the test of time is the ability to bring it back and say, I know what it means to be broken. And I know what it means to receive Jesus Christ and the love that has overwhelmed my chaos. Say, you know what? No longer am I going back to the darkness. I keep on running back to the light. I keep on living in the light. I'm doing my best to put it into practice, chase after him. I'm just doing my best to do what God has called me. I'm doing my best to live righteously. God, we live our lives beating our chests saying, God, we are unworthy. By your grace, though, you loved us so much you were willing to give up your best for us so that we can live free. For some of us in the room today, Jesus has to get out of our box. We got to take Jesus out of our box and let him be who he is so that he can transform us into who he has designed us to be. We're hanging on to the darkness because it's bringing comfort today. But just like an addict, it's fun for a moment, but it brings destruction at the end of it. You know where it all ends. You're hanging on to the anger and the frustration. You're hanging on to the pain. You won't let it go. You're hanging on to the unforgiveness. And it's much easier in your mind, and it's a lie of the enemy to keep you locked in to the darkness. But Jesus is the light. And today, my heart is that this whole chapter that John is speaking about is, hey, don't believe the lie of culture that will tell you something that isn't true. We know Jesus for who he is, and we know what he did. Now, here's the deal. We serve a God that is pure. And if we know God, then we walk in purity ourselves. So today, maybe it's saying, you know what? Rather than living in the shadows, allowing the darkness to be our existence, we say, forget that life and forget that lie. And we step into the light today and say, God, we want all of you. We want all of you. Whatever the darkness is, maybe it's overt. Maybe you do got a problem with alcohol. Maybe you got a problem with drugs. Maybe you got a problem with relationships. Maybe you are living as not a bona fide prostitute, but you are living practically as one. Dare I say, let me use cultural language. Dare I say your body count is really, really high. And you're using your body for self-glorification because you believe the lie of the enemy that you can do what you want, when you want, how you want. That's not true. Remove the darkness. Come into the light. Let's stand up to our feet today as we close this out. What I want us to do is sit in a time of reflection and say, God, search us. Where are we at? Whatever thoughts we have that are out of alignment, whatever heart posture we have that's out of alignment, whatever actions we have that's out of alignment, everybody's in a different place. But all of us can walk from the darkness of what is into the light of what God has for us. For some of us, it's fundamental. It's saying yes to Jesus Christ. For others, it's deep on the inside of us. And it's saying we are willing to confront this one thing that is holding us back from the truth, living in the truth, walking in the truth, and living in alignment with what God has asked us to do today. Here's what Jesus says in John chapter 8, verse number 12. He says, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. Jesus, we come to you, the light of the world. Wherever we are at on this journey, God, would you help us follow you? Would you help us deal with the present darkness, God? And Lord, would you lead us into the light? God, we confront any behavior, any mentality, any thinking, God, that's out of alignment with your will. God, any area of our life that is displeasing to you, God, sift us like wheat. Exposing us what needs to be dealt with, God. That, Father, your work can bring light to our lives. In Jesus' name, come on. As I was praying right now, there's one group of people I want to talk to. If you're in here today and you feel dead, obviously not physically, but you feel dead in there. There's an emptiness on the inside. You're existing, but you don't have life. You're existing and there's no joy. You feel dead. This is what I felt like God put on my heart to address. You feel dead and you want to feel life again. You want to feel alive again. All of that comes with purpose. All of that comes with emotions and feeling. All of that comes with like a hope for the future. But today, the darkness has overwhelmed you and all you see is death. All you feel is death. And you believe this is your existence. It's just to make it by. God's got something far better than that. If this is you today, raise your hand and say, Pastor, that's me. You're speaking to me today. I feel death and I want to come alive today. In Jesus' name. Come on, there's some hands that aren't raised right now, and that's fine. If you saw somebody around you and they're close to you, would you just put your hand on the shoulder? Here's the deal about being brothers and sisters in Christ. Your pain is our pain. Your hopes are our hopes. We hope that all that God has planned for you would come to fruition. We want to see you healed. We want to see you restored. We want to see you living the life that Jesus came to give us, the abundant life. So if you would, raise your hand and we'll just pray for you right now. We'll just do it all together as one big church, saying, God, would you do it for them? God, we pray today, Lord, just as you brought dead things literally back to life, Lazarus dead for 4 days, you called him back out of the grave. God, we pray for any individual in this house today. They feel dead. 10 years, decades, God. Would you bring them back to life? Jesus, would you illuminate their life today, God? Would you supernaturally heal their hearts? Would you supernaturally illuminate their minds? God, would you remove all the darkness? Everywhere the enemy has taken a foothold in their lives, God, would you break the bondage in Jesus' name? Would you loose them and set them free? That God, life would be found again. Holy Spirit, overwhelm them with your presence. Fill them up like never before. Fill them to a capacity they can't contain, God. May they experience a joy that passes all understanding. Father, bring life again to them. Bring hope again to them. Father, give them a future in Jesus' name. Give them a vision for their lives again, Jesus. Father, raise them up today with new life in Jesus' name. May your work on the cross be a finished work in our lives here today, God. We hold on to you as the eternal truth and the life. Lead us into life, Jesus. We pray this in your name, the name above every other name, the name that conquered death, hell, and the grave, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen in the house today. Can we give him glory? Amen.